Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, there's a line in Scripture, if I can dive right in, that says, do not judge or you too will be judged. And I would dare say that line might be the most quoted line in the entire Bible at this point. I think maybe some of us would argue John 3:16. We see that on posters still at football games and things like that. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever, oh my goodness, I'm blanking on the most famous line. Help me out here. Mumble, yes, give their life to Jesus, yes. We'll never perish, live forever. John 3:16, I would venture to say, maybe that's the drugs. Can we blame that on the drugs? I would venture to say, and some would argue, do not judge, lest you will be judged, is quoted just as much, if not more so, than John 3:16. We're going to pick it up in Jesus' most famous of all of his teachings. We've been looking at this for a couple months. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. This is what Jesus said. He said, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. Do not judge. Right there. Words of Jesus. We're going to break this down. We actually talked about this a few months ago, and I got a little bit of blowback. I got a little bit of pushback on not explaining this well. I hope we do this well today. There's really different concepts of judgment, and I want to make sure we understand this. In fact, this is a good time to pause and encourage you. There's an option that some of you aren't aware of or don't take advantage of through our app. We have a Colonial Church app, and if you click on Sundays and you click on message notes, then you can follow along. I'm going to throw several quotes at you today by different people. They're all going to be there in the notes. I'm going to throw different passages of Scripture at you today. They're all going to be there in the notes. There's even some fill-in-the-blank for those of you that easily nod off. It's a good way to like just track with me and stay with me. But if you click on Sundays on the app and then message notes, it'll be there. But we're going to look at three different concepts of judgment that Jesus might be talking about. First of all, there's this idea of civil judgment. Think Law and Order. Any Law and Order fans out there? It's like the longest running show in television history, 450-something episodes. I think I've seen them all. I think that's probably a red flag. But we think courtrooms. We think lawyers and judges. Clearly, this is not what Jesus is talking about when he says, do not judge. He's not saying, hey, when you're dreaming about what you're going to do with your life, when you grow up, don't be a lawyer, don't be a judge. That's not what Jesus is saying here. Another concept of judgment is that of discernment. Judgment of discernment. Discerning or judging whether something is good or bad, whether something is light or darkness, safe or dangerous. It's like what you're doing when you peek over the edge of the Grand Canyon and you immediately pull back. You discern in that moment. You judge that it might be good and smart to stay away from the edge. That's judgment of discernment. It's what you're doing when you're looking at a friend who's making really bad choices with his life or her life, destructive choices, and you're like, hey, man, I love you. Don't do that. You're discerning. You're judging that's not a good thing. This is also not what Jesus is talking about here when he says, don't do that. Don't judge. That's not what Jesus is talking about. We know this. Another concept of judgment is value judgment, judging value, which in some cases is totally cool. It's like, maybe a bad example for me right now, judging the value of my motorcycle that I just wrecked. I might say it's worth $8,000. You might say it's worth $6,000. My wife might say it's worth a grand, you know? She just wants to get rid of it. That's value judgment. But when you and I determine the value of people, that's when we've crossed the line. Jesus is saying here, I think we can understand this in this teaching, Jesus is saying here that we're not free to judge the value of other people. Only God can do this. To value judge people is to be a fault finder. Any fault finders in your life come to mind? Someone who is negative, who's destructive toward people, maybe even enjoys finding fault in people. Paul writes about this in the New Testament. Paul writes in one of his letters to the Christians that were in the city of Rome, he writes, who are you to condemn someone else's servants? Their own master will judge whether they stand or fall. and with the Lord's help, they will stand and receive his approval. Paul writes in another letter to some Christians in the city of Corinth. He writes, "My conscience is clear, but that doesn't prove I'm right. It is the Lord himself who will examine me and decide. So don't make judgments about anyone ahead of time before the Lord returns." He's talking about value judgments of people. We are not God. No human being is qualified to judge the value of people. We can't see people's hearts, right? We can't see people's motives. Only God can see. Only God can truly judge. So when it comes to really what we're talking about today, when it comes to Jesus teaching us his people, what it means to experience life, to experience community, to experience relationships with each other, as we come under his gracious rule, Jesus is actually calling us the other direction. He's saying, don't limit the value of people. No, actually be generous with the value you put on people. Assume the best. Overestimate the value of people, Jesus is saying. Think critically, be wise, and I would just put it this way, let God judge. Let God judge. Today marks the end of a couple of months for us of looking at the Sermon on the Mount. This is what we call the most famous teaching of all of Jesus' teachings. It's the longest recorded teaching of any of the things Jesus did and said. Matthew records it in three chapters of his gospel, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Scholars argue it's the least understood of all his teachings. Scholars argue it's the least obeyed of all his teachings. We're in the last chapter of it, the first 12 verses of chapter 7, and we see here Jesus teaching us about relationships, how to have relationships with people as we come under his gracious rule. I'll remind you, not under the tyrannical rule of someone like King George. That's a good metaphor for the day, right? As we look at our birthday of our country. We think of the rule of a king as thumb on us and power over us. No, the gracious rule of God is what Jesus teaches that we're invited to come under and then experience life differently. He teaches us, let God judge. Don't try to be God. Don't place value judgments on people. Only he can do that. And then Jesus says, don't be a hypocrite. This is a hard word for his people to hear today, for Jesus' people. We're not only not supposed to be God, we're not in the business of judging like we are, like we can see people's hearts and motives. We're also need to be painfully aware, Jesus says here, is that we got our own stuff. We got our own junk. We're all sinners. It goes all the way back to the beginning. We can read about it in Genesis chapter 3, when everything went south, when everything got infected because of our sin, because of our selfishness. I think for me, I'm amazed at how easy it is for me to exaggerate the faults of other people and minimize my own. Anybody relate to that at all? Like, I can see y'all's issues. They're huge. Huge. Mine, it's like I have rose-colored glasses on and discolored glasses when I look at other people. It's amazing how I can do that. That's called sin. That's called hypocrisy. Look at what Jesus says. Verse 3 says, why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye, when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite. First get rid of the log in your own eye, then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. There it is. That's the picture of me. That's the picture of us, isn't it? There's the direct description of us when we do this, right here in the middle. Hypocrite. Very simple, direct, challenging word from our King, who wants us to experience life differently, who wants us to experience relationships, community, radically differently. Don't be a hypocrite. Quit pointing your finger at other people. Spend more time looking in the mirror, examining our own hearts, searching for how we need to change, considering how we need to repent. It's that religious word, repent. It means pull a 180, Not how do those people or that person need to really change their life. How do I need to change? How do I need to humble myself? Now, on a more positive note, those are some hard words from Jesus. In this same section, Jesus does call us to be brothers and sisters to each other. Look back at this same paragraph and notice the language Jesus uses. I think we could miss this if we're not paying attention. He says, why worry about a speck in your friend's eye? How can you think of saying to your friend? Deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Over and over again, he says your friend. The original Greek here that we translate in English, your friend, it actually means your brother. It doesn't mean acquaintance or even friend. It means your brother. Meaning, Jesus is not really talking about just some acquaintance on the street or somebody you don't know. He's talking about your brother in Christ, your sister in Christ, your faith family. When you and I remove the log of self-righteousness, then we're able to see, with the eyes of humility, the speck that our Christian friends may have. Here's the deal. A mark of what it means to be spiritual family together. I think it's appropriate we're talking about being spiritual family together today. We're going to have a meal right after this. Anybody who doesn't know, we're going to break bread after this. We got a ton of food right down the hall right after this service that we're all going to enjoy. Can't wait. A mark of what it means to be spiritual family together is the responsibility each of us has to help each other remove the speck of sin from each other's lives. We're supposed to do that. I joke about it all the time. If I've got a booger hanging out of my nose and you don't tell me, you are not my friend. Right? Friends don't do that to friends, right? You tell them. If I've got a speck in my eye, I want you to help me. I want you to help me remove it. Jesus just starts the conversation where it needs to be, which is, okay, let's start with you. Get the log out of your own eye first. But that doesn't mean we're not meant to be family together. William Warren said it this way. He says, after self-criticism takes place, relationships are based on redemptive empathy rather than condemning detachment. Now, that's a bunch of ACT words, but I really like that quote. I've been thinking about that this week. I want to read that again. After self-criticism takes place, so after I start with me and I look inward, relationships are based on redemptive empathy. Redemptive, that means life-giving, restoring empathy, which means I'm putting myself in other people's shoes, I'm caring for other people, I'm seeing the world the way they do, I'm thinking for them, about them, instead of condemning detachment. Jesus said, first get rid of the log in your own eye, then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Let God judge, don't be a hypocrite, but in the right, humble, helpful ways, be family for each other. Don't just go to church. Don't just tag along in different activities, but really speak into each other's lives humbly with the best of intentions. God does not say we are not to say hard words to each other, words of challenge that each of us needs to hear at different times. He just says, let me judge. I'm the one who can see the hearts and motives of people. You can't. Don't be a hypocrite. Deal with your own junk first. Be humble. But then he says, from that place of humility, help each other. Be family. Deal with your own junk first humbly, and then you'll be able to bless your brother. You'll be able to bless your sister in Christ. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. I like the words of the early church father, John Chrysostom. He says, correct him, but not as a foe, nor as an adversary exacting a penalty, but as a physician providing medicines. That's speaking to me lately. My doctor's my favorite person right now. Taking care of me, giving me some good stuff. Not my foe, not as an adversary exacting a penalty. Correcting like a physician providing medicines. In my relationships with people, I want to be eager to restore. I, I want to be eager to fight for healthy connection. I want to be critical of myself way more often than I am of other people. I want to be generous toward other people and their value every bit as much, if not more so, than I am of my own. Okay, let's shift gears. Here's where the words of Jesus might actually throw us for a loop. Because then he says, don't waste what is holy on people who are unholy. Don't throw your pearls to pigs. That's the New Living Translation that we often read here at Colonial. Another common English translation, the NIV, puts it this way. Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. Jesus is talking about dogs and pigs. What in the world? What does he mean? Well, I want to remind you, Jesus speaks really directly at times. He called King Herod Antipas a fox at one point, and he did not mean that in a good way. He called the hypocritical religious leaders of his day whitewashed tombs, saying they were dead on the inside. He called them a brood of snakes. Now he seems to be calling some people dogs and pigs. Who are the dogs and pigs here he's talking about? Well, scholars actually disagree on this, so I want to share a couple things with you. Some historians point out to us that Jews often referred to non-Jews, to what they call Gentiles, as dogs. That sounds awful to us, but that was part of the language of their day. So it's possible that Jesus is saying here, don't take the Torah, the holy ancient Hebrew scriptures, and throw them before these non-Jews. We can't take things we believe and expect non-believers to adhere to the same things. If this is what Jesus means, then we need to take a good look at ourselves. I think many of us as Christians do this all the time. These might be some random examples, but I just want you to think about this. We think it's right and good and downright normal to pray before a Friday night football game starts, right? And we expect everyone in the stadium, including all the non-Christians, gathered in the stadium to do the same. We think it's right and good to bless our neighbors when we can and give them the benefit of the doubt when conflict comes up. So we expect them to do the same with us, even though they may not have chosen to come under the gracious rule of God. The people around us, even in our community, even here in Bible Belt, Wichita Falls, Texas, may not have chosen to make the Bible, for example, their measuring stick for how to live. We love to speak about our views of righteousness and morality, good and bad, right and wrong, and we expect the world to listen to us. But I just want to pose the question today, why would the world listen to us? They haven't agreed to follow God's word and live by it and live under his gracious rule like we have. If Jesus' reference to dogs is about non-Jews, and so for us, as Christians, it's about non-Christians, then that makes sense. He's saying don't waste what is holy, what is set apart, on people who are unholy, who are not set apart. Well, that's one way of looking at it. But other scholars suggest Jesus is talking here about any people who are in opposition to God. That Jesus is talking about people who've heard the gospel and they've rejected it. They've stiff-armed God. Even some people who are defiantly against Jesus. If this interpretation is accurate, it does fit. Later, for example, when Jesus is sending out his disciples, Matthew chapter 10, same gospel we're reading a few chapters later, he says, if any household or town refuses to welcome you or listen to your message, shake its dust from your feet as you leave. Move on. And it fits with what we read about even the missionary work of Paul and Barnabas later in the book of Acts. It says, then the Jews stirred up the influential religious women and the leaders of the city, and they incited a mob against Paul and Barnabas and ran them out of town. So they shook the dust from their feet as a sign of rejection and went to the town of Iconium. They just moved on. Okay. And then again in the city of Rome, and this might hit home for us because this is really what Paul's talking about, the gospel exploding, when some of the Jewish leaders in Rome, they wouldn't choose Jesus. They rejected Jesus. Paul said this. He said, I want you to know that this salvation from God has also been offered to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews. and they will accept it. You don't want the good news of Jesus? You don't want the life-changing goodness of God? All right, somebody else will want it. What does this mean for us, this passage, that some difficult words Jesus has for us 21st century Christians when it comes to relationships, specifically with non-Christians or people who are against Jesus? Well, it means don't expect Jesus-like behavior. Don't expect Jesus-like behavior from non-Christians. I remember when, a long time ago, when I used to work for an organization called Young Life, and we took two busloads of high school kids from Houston all the way to a week-long experience in the Colorado Rockies. And we did that every summer for several years. It was amazing. One year, I remember we weren't very far down the road at all, and one of our brand new Young Life leaders named Brian came and found me on the bus, and he was freaking out. And he said, "Loren, there's some guys, some high school guys in the back row, and they're dropping F-bombs, and they're being jerks to people, and I don't know what to do." And I said, "Brian, we are on our way to an amazing camp experience where the gospel of Jesus is going to be laid out really clearly for people who don't know him." Wow, isn't this cool? Sounds like we got the right boys on the bus. Don't expect Jesus-like behavior from non-Christians. And, I hope this is freeing, let the gospel do its thing. It's not up to you or me to save people. It's not up for you or me to draw people to God. Jesus even says this in John 6:44. He says, "For no one can come to me unless the Father, God the Father, who sent me, draws them to me." Jesus said it. Nobody can come to Jesus unless God the Father supernaturally draws them to himself. This is one of the mysteries of our faith. And that word draws, the Greek word there translated, it means to drag. It goes in one direction. It's not a push and a pull. It's all God pulling. It's God dragging. Clearly, this drawing is a one-sided affair. God does the drawing to salvation. We who are drawn have a fairly passive role in the process. Some freedom in that, right? Especially for some of you in the room who are like high achievers, high responsibility Christians, that you really just, you want to save people. I just want to remind you, let the gospel do its thing. Doesn't mean we don't share our faith boldly. Doesn't mean we don't tell people how good God is and what he's done. We just don't carry the weight of responsibility of what they do with the good news. God, that's one of the ways God loves all of us. All of us, is he gives us freedom. He gives us free will to reject him, to accept him. And then Jesus takes us to a radically different way of experiencing relationship with him. He already talked about experiencing relationship with each other, being family. Don't be hypocrites, don't judge, just be family to each other. He talked about how we are to treat non-Christians or people who are against him. Don't expect Jesus-like behavior. Let the gospel do its thing. And then he shifts gears, and I think somebody here needs to hear this today, because he paints a very different picture next of how we interact with God. This is what he says, verse 7. "Keep on asking, and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking, and you will find. Keep on knocking, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and to everyone who knocks, the door will be opened." You parents, if your children ask for a loaf of bread, do you give them a stone instead? Or if they ask for a fish, do you give them a snake? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? Jesus paints a very different picture of who God the Father is. What do you think God the Father's like? Think he's a killjoy? Think he's got a lot of do's and don'ts? You think he's absent? You think he doesn't care? Jesus says, keep on asking. Keep on knocking. He's right there. We've already looked at the words of Jesus on prayer. A couple weeks ago in this teaching, Chad and Heather did a great job of just walking through instructions from Jesus on how to pray. And now Jesus kicks it up a notch, and he gives us promises we can bank on. Promises that God, our Father, is listening when we pray. You ever wonder if he's listening? Talking to the ceiling at night? Talking to yourself? Is he even there? Promise from Jesus that God, our Father, is listening. Promises from Jesus that he's a good, good Father. Promises that he invites us to be bold, like little kids do with their dads, like little kids do with their moms. I love how John Calvin said it, recorded 550 years ago. He said, "Nothing is better adapted to excite us to prayer than full conviction that we shall be heard." Nothing motivates us to pray more than just this belief that he is listening. Martin Luther said this 600 years ago. He says, "He knows that we are timid and shy, that we feel unworthy and unfit to present our needs to God. We think that God is so great and we are so tiny that we do not dare to pray. That is why Christ wants to lure us away from such timid thoughts, to remove our doubts, and to have us go ahead confidently and boldly." Do you see God like that? Think about parenting. What parent would give a child a rock, or worse, a snake, if a little kid asked for food? Who does that? Bad parents don't even do that. That's what Jesus says. How much more would God, who loves us, who literally says, "I adopt you into my family, you are my children," how much more does he love us? When it comes to our relationship with God our Father, Jesus tells us to be a confident, bold child. Does your relationship with God look like that? A confident, bold child. Can you think for a moment what that looks like? Close your eyes for a moment. Right now, about something you care about, pray a very short, to yourself, pray very, very short prayer to God, boldly, obnoxiously, like a little 3 or 4 year old would say it. What if your prayers looked like that? That's what he wants. That's what he invites us to. To come to him like confident, bold children. And finally, Jesus, in this last section of his famous teaching, instructs us how to experience relationships with everybody in general. He lands the plane here in verse 12 by telling us, this is how I want you to interact with everybody. And before we look at this, before we wrap this up here, I want to quote Mahatma Gandhi, and you've probably heard this before, but I want to talk about this for a minute. Gandhi once said, "Religions are different roads converging to the same point. What does it matter that we take different roads so long as we reach the same goal?" That's a very popular thought these days. There's a lot of roads that lead to the same place, a lot of religions that all land in the same place. And I think that what we're about to read that Jesus said is even referred to in this conversation about how all these roads kind of lead to the same place. Let me read to you what Jesus said next, Matthew 7, verse 12. Jesus said, "Do to others whatever you would like them to do to you." This is the essence of all that is taught in the law and the prophets. Anybody know what we often call this? Somebody yell that out. Golden rule. I think maybe the translation I've heard a lot as a kid is, "Do unto others whatever you would have them do to you." The New Living Translation says, "Do to others whatever you would like them to do to you." People have pointed to this teaching of Jesus called the Golden Rule and said, yeah, that's like in lots of different religions. All roads lead to the same place. But I want to be really clear about how this famous line from Jesus is uniquely different than all these other religions. How Jesus calls us way farther than all these other religious teachings. If we look at Eastern religions, for example, like Jainism or Buddhism or Hinduism, They are all based on this rule called ahimsa. I don't know if you're familiar with that word, ahimsa, which means to do no harm or to cause no injury. So if we, this is my fancy graph I made for today, okay? I may or may not have been taking something when I did this. We've got this axis that shows love increasing and difficulty increasing. And right here we have this idea of ahimsa, ahimsa, do no harm. That can be argued to be a really good thing, right? I mean, medical professionals, y'all study that, right? One of my first rules, don't hurt anybody, right? Do no harm. There are a lot of religions that teach nonviolence, that teach don't hurt anybody. That's a good thing. Some have even called ahimsa the silver rule. It's not the golden rule. It's good, but there's something better. Jesus said to do to others whatever you would like them to do to you. So we have this next point here. Another way he said it, this rings a bell, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Do to others what you would like them to do to you. This is higher on the love scale. This is further out on the difficulty scale, because it's not just not hurting, it's actually loving. I like how Dallas Willard puts it. He's one of my favorite writers. He says, the golden rule is devoted to the good in the lives of those around us, and this reaches far beyond the mere absence of harm. It aspires toward a remarkable richness in their lives, not simply the alleviation of their suffering. We don't just want to make it not hurt for people. We actually want to love them. We want to bring goodness to them. Several religions stop short at teaching nonviolence. But the true path, the way of Jesus, actually calls us to seek the flourishing of other people. And then let's keep going. Go back to that other chart. What's even more difficult, even more loving? That ring a bell from the 1990s? Anybody got a WWJD bracelet on them right now? Come on, don't be shy. Somebody out there has one on right now. Oh, you're holding back on me. I think it actually started in the 19th century, but in the 1990s, it got really popular, and we all went around with t-shirts and bracelets that said WWJD. What would Jesus do? Not do to others whatever you would like them to do to you. Do what you think Jesus would do. That's higher on the love scale. That's further out on the difficulty scale. Well, I want to poke a couple holes in this. Ultimately, we can't really know what Jesus would do all the time. We're not God, right? Even the times we can have a pretty good idea what we think Jesus would do in a situation, it's so hard. He's God in the flesh. We can't always do what Jesus would do. Thankfully, I want to bring it down to earth for us today. In this famous teaching, the Sermon on the Mount, that we're wrapping up our study of today, Jesus gives us a more doable command. We don't have to know what Jesus would do. We don't have to necessarily do what Jesus would do. We only have to know what we would do. We only have to do what we would wish would be done. Instead of asking WWJD, we can ask WWIW. What would I want? Instead of setting the bar so high by saying we should act like Jesus, the golden rule that Jesus gives us here in Matthew chapter 7, it actually puts obedience within our reach. Makes our own conscience the standard. We treat other people the way we want to be treated. Said a different way, we are to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. According to Jesus, we are to love like we want to be loved. I like how Jesus lays out what relationships, what community looks like for us if we will follow him, if we will trust him, if we will give him everything, if we will come under his gracious rule. He gives us words to live by. He gives us words to follow and experience community and relationship radically differently than the rest of the world. Would you guys stand with me now? We're going to wrap up today. We're not really done yet. Not only do we have food coming, but we're actually going to sing a little bit, so don't check out on me. I want to go ahead and ask the response team, if you guys could go ahead and come up to the front. I've asked Tanner to help me with this. I want to tie all this together, and I want to give us just a chance. It's our one service today. maybe for you to do some business with God. If we can tie this together, these last several things that Jesus has said toward the end of his famous Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is calling us up, in, and out. We use that language around Colonial from time to time. Jesus calls us up, in, and out. It's not an individualistic me thing like we like to make it. It's a call into relationships, into community. It's a call up to relationship with a very real, very good Father, an intimate connection with him that he invites all of us to experience. It's a call in to experience friendship and community way differently than we think on a deeper level. And it's a call out to love the people around us like we want to be loved, to bless the people around us, to extend grace and trust him to draw people to himself. Jesus calls us up, in, and out to relationships, to trust our good, perfect Father, to submit to our all-powerful, loving King. So I just want to give you a chance right now. If you want to choose today, maybe one or two of you today, if you want to choose today for the first time to place your trust in the only one worthy, ultimately, of trusting, why not make today, July 4th, 2021, the day that you give him everything, that you come under his gracious rule? While we're singing this next song about our good Father, I want you to come talk to one of these folks down front, Shantae, Don, Brett over here. They would love to pray with you, to celebrate with you, to talk about next steps. If you want to choose today to be baptized, we're not actually going to dunk you in the water today, but we'll make a plan with you today. If something's already happened on the inside of your life, you've already given him control, you've already given him your heart, your mind, and you just haven't followed through yet with believer's baptism, come talk to one of these folks. Let's make a plan. Let's do that together. If you just need to be prayed over, if you just need to come and pray and ask for help, ask some questions, that's what these folks are here together to do with us. God is good. Would you lead us, Tanner? You need a couple minutes? You're good? All right. Let's worship together our good, good Father.
So we just sing, you can just make your way, and as he said, just these guys are down here ready for some prayer. Sing this out with us.
Oh, I heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I heard a tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and tell that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. Who I am, who I am. perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, it's a love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love as you call me.
Come on, sing.
Deeper. I am, you're a good, good father. To you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're a good, good father. It's who you are.
Come on, lift your voice.
It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Come on, can we praise? Can we praise in church? Come on. So thank you so much for singing. We're gonna close out our service with one more song. And it's just to kind of really take this moment of prayer into rejoicing. So can we do that? I need your help. It's me and Shelby up here on stage, and I need your help for this one. We want to celebrate what God's doing. Even the moments that he's created for us, even the times he's speaking to us there in our service, we want to celebrate. And we're fixing to go have a party as a church, but we need your help, okay? So can we sing this out at the top of our lungs? Can we just praise God for who he is and get ready to go have some fun together? Can we do that? Cool, let's sing this out.
And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am drenched in love. My soul's atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to what once held me again. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am drenched in love.
Sing, oh precious.
And oh precious is the flow that makes me why. And oh, I'm not ashamed of what will shackle me. How infinite that grace divine. I am free, I am free, I am a child of God. Yeah,
you believe it?
And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. There is power in the blood of Jesus.
Yeah.
How price. How. There is power.
Come on.
How priceless. How precious. There is power in the blood of.
You believe this?
How priceless. How precious. There is power in the blood. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Yes, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Yeah, I was buried deep with Christ my Lord. Now I'm raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart.
Hey!
And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am drenched in love. And oh, precious is the flow. I am washed, I am drenched in love.
Like I just got transported back in time or something. A little country church. We're about to have potluck dinner, so to speak. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray. And our response team, if you guys can hang around, for a few more minutes in case other folks want to come down and pray with you. All the rest of us, we're going to get our kids first. Okay, don't leave all the kids workers up there hanging while you're eating. Okay, get our kids first and we're going to go to the cafe. We got tons of food. We got more than we need. We'll have some more folks coming in. They think we're having church in about 20 minutes. They're going to find out we're just having a big meal, okay? So let me pray for us and we'll do it. God, thank you that we get to be family together. Thank you that it starts with you, who loves us just as we are, not as we're supposed to be. Thank you for your grace, your forgiveness. Thank you for being the one who rebuilds, the one who restores. Thank you, Father. Lord, we need you. We need more of you. We need more of you in us, Father, working in us. We want to be your faithful people. We want to experience everything you invite us into. Even the way we break bread now and laugh and talk and play games outside together with our kids, with our friends. We make new friends, we meet new people. All of this, Father, we just make an offering to you and just trust you're grinning from ear to ear as you're right in the middle of it with us. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we'll see you in the cafe.